Well, let's get started. So a couple of faces I don't recognize. I'm Tom Rohde. I'm the founder of Renew Total Body Wellness Center. Thank you all for coming in tonight to take some time to learn about regenerative medicine and what we do here. And so we do a lot of things that tie together with this. We're going to focus towards the end a little bit on joints, but I want to start from the beginning and kind of explain all the things we do, because everybody's here not because they came for our wonderful hors d'oeuvres, but maybe because they have some joint problems. And a lot of people wonder, well, how did I get here? And so I'm going to try and go through some of that and talk about what we can do to help prevent that. So if I get that to work, I've got a little video clip to start out. I want you to think about this. So I just wanted everybody to think about that for a minute, because health is a choice. And unfortunately, we live life with reckless abandon for 20, 30, 40 years, and then things don't work so well anymore, and we wonder what happened, and trying to come up with a way to do that. Whoop. Well, Danielle, let's see if we can get beyond this thing. It doesn't want to advance. There we go. Okay. So we talked about health. And the word they used in the video is vitality. And that's actually more important than just health, because a lot of people think, well, they're healthy if they don't have any symptoms or they don't have some sort of disease. But I think there's a difference between health and actually vitality, and having the energy to do what you want to do even into your 80s, 90s, and I think we're going to be living into our hundreds now. So thinking about what can you do to improve that. And so what we really do here is to go back to what God designed, a self-healing mechanism. If we stop doing things that prevent our body from actually healing and doing what He designed it to do. And so if you think about it, you know, how do you get results? Well, we combine a lot of things. I work together with chiropractors, I work together with physical therapists, whatever it takes to get people back into the best function that they can have. And I think it works well. The Amish have a nice saying for that, many hands make light work. And so if we work together, I think that's helpful. We try and do tests and lab evaluation to figure out, okay, what's causing the problem, to get to the root cause of the problem. We don't just try to treat symptoms. We really want to find out what can we do. And then we work to repair it. And nutrition, I think, is probably the most important word down here, because the majority of what we see with people that have health issues is lifestyle disease. And so weight loss, exercise, better sleep, and those are all important things to work. And if we start to put all this together, really it starts to function together, and then we end up getting results. And that's really what everybody wants, I think. So question, are we healthy? And you know, we just talked about that, and we make up 5% of the world's population, but we spend more than 95% on our health in other countries, if you think about the amount of money that's spent on healthcare in the US. And we consume over 75% of the world's medications. So think about all the Walgreens, CVS's, Walmarts with pharmacies, and try to figure out, okay, where are we at health-wise with that? Barb Starfield is a doc, and she did a study. She's was the health of the head of the health and health policy management at Johns Hopkins, and she wrote an article in JAMA in 2000 on the effectiveness of American healthcare. And so this has been quite a while ago, if you think about it, 20 years ago. And you know, Americans eat a steady diet of pills, and that's why we have so many pharmacies. And unfortunately, those things cause side effects and interactions. And back in 2000, she said the third leading cause of death in the United States really turns out to be the medical treatment of patients, and there are 225,000 deaths per year from medical treatment. And that's kind of sad if you think about what we're spending money on in that. So 106,000 of those deaths in her study were from side effects of properly prescribed medications. So those were medications that were properly prescribed. There wasn't a problem with the prescription. 80,000 from hospital-caused infections. I don't know if anybody's heard of anyone getting a hospital-acquired infection, but that's becoming more apparent with all these bacteria resistances from overuse of antibiotics. 12,000 from unnecessary surgery. I don't want to comment a whole lot of that, but a lot of surgery gets done. My hallmark of a good surgeon is somebody that says you don't need surgery because that's how they make money, unfortunately. 7,000 from medication errors. Those happen. You know, computers, I think, allow us to make errors more quickly. You hit the button and you get the wrong prescription sent, or somebody at the pharmacy puts the wrong pill in the bottle, or somebody in the hospital gives you your neighbor's medication, and so the outcomes are bad. And 20,000 from other errors in the hospital. I don't know what those are, but if anybody spent any time in the hospital, I always tell my patients, if you go to the hospital, you need to have a guardian angel there with you to look at medications to make sure what you're having done procedure-wise or surgery is really for you and they're doing the right thing. So they did another study, the U.S. versus 16 peer nations, so similar types of populations, and the health study, 17 highest income nations were ranked, and looking at multiple diseases, injuries, and behavior over the entire lifespan. And the sad part of that is that, you know, when we look at that, the U.S. came in last. And so it's kind of sad when you think about how much money we spend and how we're doing. So 17th place in weight, body mass index, diabetes, infant mortality, and a probability of dying between 15 and 50. And that's really sad if you think about, you know, people dying at such a young age. And we came in last amongst all those nations. So the study was named the U.S. Health Disadvantage. And it has only gotten worse in the 20 years that's been going on. Barb, unfortunately, died in 2011 of a cerebral bleed due to the Plavix she was taking while she was swimming. And she said medical treatment is the third leading cause of death in the U.S. and the oral antiplatelet agents, which is what Plavix is, are very common causes of adverse events in people 65 and older. And so she died from the very thing she wrote about in her article, which is really kind of sad. And it gets worse. In 2017, people repeated her study, and the leading cause of death in the U.S. is now medicine. You know, if you ask people what's the leading cause of death, everybody says, oh, heart disease or cancer. Well, no, it's actually the American medical system. So I put myself in that category as a physician. And you know, you think about all the things that people die of, but the healthcare system is the number one cause of medicine if you look at the number of deaths. And we far exceed the COVID, by the way. So this goes back to the video, you know, how do you want to live your life? Do you want to get by or do you want to live your best life? And really our goal here is to help people get back to living their best life. You know, do you see yourself with a walker or do you see yourself out jogging and being really active? Because you don't want to end up on the sidelines. And we can do that. So one of the things that causes problems is senescence, which means cellular aging. And so the lifestyle we live is caused by all the things that we're involved in, you know, nutrient signaling, chronic inflammation, stem cells exhausting out. And I want to touch on that a little bit because we're going to talk about stem cells, mitochondrial dysfunction, DNA damage from toxins, same thing with the mitochondria, the toxins, telomere erosion. The telomeres are the end caps on our chromosomes, and when your telomere bank is empty, that cell can't divide anymore, and it literally dies. And so if you think about when we're young, we have lots of healthy, active stem cells. As we age, they kind of decrease in number, and that's part of the aging process and why generally we heal really well when we're young, and as we start to age, we don't heal quite as quickly as we used to because our stem cells are part of our healing and repair mechanism. And so let's talk about what causes that body degeneration, because that's really the root cause of all this, and it's truly inflammation. And one of the biggest things that cause inflammation in our body is the American diet, which I call the SAD diet, or the standard American diet, because it's so inflammatory. You know, so acute inflammation we need. And so you think about some of the mechanisms: sports, weekend warrior, work injuries, twist your ankle at work or in a sporting event. And you need some acute inflammation to start the healing process, because it really kicks up the body's immune system, drawing in those healing factors to start the healing process. So we need a well-controlled healing process. We need a campfire that's controlled. We don't want an out-of-control forest fire. Okay? And so chronic inflammation is what leads to all the damage in our body, but it needs to be time limited. So you want to heal that injury, whether it's work or weekend or whatever. So you do some rest, ice, elevation, compression, and then mobilize early. Mobilization is important, that joint fluid pump. So if you sprain your knee, for instance, that movement, the active movement, pumps healing fluids in. We need that circulation and oxygen, and joints are notoriously low in that. They don't have a lot of direct blood supply. And persistent inflammation in a joint leads to joint damage. And so whatever we can do to increase circulation and oxygenation into the joint, I think, is important, as it is for the rest of the body. So short-term treatment, what do most people do? You grab some non-steroidal medications, right? They're sold over the counter. It's one of the leading causes of medication. But there are some studies, I'm going to jump to that in a bit, they actually decrease stem cell release and stem cell function. And those are our healing and repair mechanisms. So maybe some better natural choices. Vitamin C, awesome antioxidant, and it also helps with collagen formation, which is part of the cartilage lining in the joints. There are actually some good studies that show just lack of vitamin C without any damage to the joint leads to degeneration of joints, because you can't reform the collagen. So just wear and tear, even if you're not an athlete, you don't injure it. If you have a lack of vitamin C over time, you're going to have wear and tear on that joint. So a simple thing to do is add in vitamin C. And we've been talking a lot about that recently, just with health promotion and keeping your immune system working well. Some other natural anti-inflammatories. I'm sure everybody's heard of curcumin or turmeric root. It's been around for 4,000 years. Fish oil is anti-inflammatory. Cat's claw, boswellia, quercetin from garlic and onions. We were just talking about some of those natural healthy foods. Even ginger is anti-inflammatory. So there's some natural choices that you can use instead of medications that have side effects. So chronic inflammation. Chronic inflammation leads to delayed healing, body damage, and ultimately to advanced aging. And so anything that drives this chronic inflammation is advanced aging. So what are signs of advanced aging? Osteoarthritis, damage to the joints, fibromyalgia, diabetes, cognitive decline. You know, how many people do we now hear about with dementia of some sort or Alzheimer's? And that is from chronic inflammation. The biggest thing that drives all this is food and lifestyle. So fast foods, I'm not going to call out any names in particular, but gluten and dairy are some of the biggest items with this, and really making sure that we eat clean, healthy foods, if you will, not foods that drive inflammation in the body. Some of the biggest things that drive inflammation are sugar and fructose. And you think about the amount of soda that people drink in this country, it really drives inflammation in the body. So the sugar in particular, let's talk about a little bit of how this works. The sugar leads to inflammation in the gut, and it causes an imbalance in your good and bad bacteria. The gram-negative bacteria tend to overgrow, and these bacteria produce a product called lipopolysaccharides. These are literally lead to metabolic endotoxemia, and so the cells that glue our intestinal structures together have little pores to allow nutrients to get through, but the inflammation widens those, and then those endotoxins that are produced by an imbalance in the bacteria get out into the system, and they lead to leaky gut, so they cause inflammation in the gut. These enter the bloodstream, and then what you end up doing is those end up leading to stimulation of NF-kappa-beta. NF-kappa-beta stimulates cytokines. I think everybody's probably heard that word recently, that those cytokines stimulate inflammation. So in a localized injury like a knee or an ankle sprain, those cytokines stimulate healing in that area, but it's a limited reaction. If you're getting this into the bloodstream, those cytokines lead to more inflammation. So if you think about dominoes lined up, one domino gets inflamed and then the cells around it start getting inflamed and those dominoes start to tip over. And then you've got body-wide inflammation. And if it gets out of control, we lead to all these things we just mentioned, including joint destruction. And that inflammation tends to go, you know, a lot of people played sports or injured their knee or their ankle or something at some point. Those are more susceptible to damage because everybody says, well, I got one good knee and one bad knee or a hip or whatever. And so prior damage kind of predisposes that inflammation to that area. Some of the worst things in our foods are the bad fats. So you've heard about trans fats and hydrogenated oils. And if our body uses these bad fats to start making cell walls, they actually end up making more toxic lipopolysaccharides. And so instead of using a match to light that campfire, now we've got a blowtorch because it's a more toxic lipopolysaccharide. And that campfire becomes a forest fire. It's just out of control. So if you think about every time we eat a food that's inflammatory, our body has to heal that inflammation. And our stem cells are part of our healing mechanism. And every time we eat something that stimulates the lipopolysaccharides, it increases that advanced aging. And we're using those stem cells to treat and fix that inflammation. So every time you have that burger, fries, and a soda that's inflammatory, you got to use some stem cells up, and you've got a limited number of stem cells. And so as we go through life, eating our sad diet, we're using up stem cells, and then when we have an injury, we're less capable of healing, and that's what happens as our age advances, why we have less of those around. And so really it comes down to diet. How many people do you know that are tired? Our mitochondria are our energy powerhouses. So every cell in the body has a mitochondria in it. It's like the ever-ready battery in your cell, and it produces your energy. And in the process of making energy, here's your ATP. So that's what makes energy. The mitochondria make ATP. You also make some free radicals. And so this is what we would call garbage or cellular dust, whatever you want to call it. These are the byproducts of making ATP. And we have an antioxidant system. That's where that vitamin C and other things like that come in to work as antioxidants. But over time with damage, you can start to see this mitochondria that has a nice smooth outline here. Look at how wrinkly and malformed it becomes. I mean, literally it damages. And you think about it, if you look at somebody's skin, it's often a mirror to how well the rest of their body's health is doing. Think about somebody that smokes versus somebody that doesn't smoke. Smokers generally tend to have a lot of wrinkly skin. Well, that cigarette smoke and those toxins is also damaging their mitochondria, and they have wrinkly mitochondria. And literally what happens is they're making less ATP, but they're making a whole bunch more free radicals because they're trying to keep up with the energy supply. And then you end up literally with advanced aging like we talked about. And so our diet, our lack of exercise, and that drives this whole process forward. Another thing, the sugars and the carbs, they increase insulin. I think everybody's heard of insulin, but insulin is actually a growth hormone and it's inflammatory. Why do people with diabetes that take insulin have a higher incidence of heart disease than people that don't have diabetes? Because they have lots of insulin floating around. And so the more insulin you have in your body, the more inflammation you're gonna drive. Elevated blood sugar also increases uric acid. Anybody heard of gout in here? Really painful. It's an acute inflammatory process, but that uric acid is elevated due to the sugar and the carbs. You start to see elevated inflammatory markers, a CRP and a sed rate, so we can measure some of those things. You know, one daily soda for 6 months, uric acid increases, which can lead to gout. High blood pressure ensues. You get insulin resistance, where your own body's insulin doesn't work as well and you have to make more, which becomes more inflammatory. You gain weight. You start to get a fatty liver from fructose. So think of the sodas you're drinking. And then ultimately, you start to produce this lipopolysaccharide, which drives this chronic inflammation. Elevated triglycerides from the fructose, say in a soda, orange juice, whatever, increases your LDL, and lowers your HDL. The HDL is the one that helps keep your heart and your blood vessels healthy. And the LDL, which we call the lousy cholesterol, when that starts to increase, that's a bad thing because it increases the risk for heart attacks and strokes. So, you know, here's a picture of an arthritic knee versus a healthy knee, and it's not uncommon to see people that have one bad knee, and this may have been injured, like I said, cheerleading, sports, a car accident where their knee hit the dashboard, and that is predisposed to that inflammatory drive in the body. So disease timeline is important because, you know, people think about, well, you know, how did I get here over time? And some diseases have a very short timeline and some have a long timeline. So you think about, you know, when your disease starts and what kind of symptoms you have. So if your symptoms start down here and they travel through a long period of time, before you start to get symptoms, clear down here, and you think about diabetes. Diabetes starts here with elevated blood sugar and that inflammation, but before you start to have any symptoms of your diabetes, like numbness in your toes and your feet, or your blood sugar becomes abnormal, there's a long time that passes and there's a lot of damage that occurs under the surface. And so that's why we sometimes find out, and you're going, well, how the heck did I end up with all these problems? You know, I was just told that my blood sugar is abnormal, because you've had this stuff ongoing under the surface before you get a symptom, actually. So different disease timeline, if you look at that, you know, can you think of a disease that has a very short timeline between, bam, you get symptoms, and you have your end of disease? Think about that chest pain. You know, you got the widowmaker that's blocked off, you know, and you get that chest pain and you drop dead and game over. But that has a very short timeline from symptom onset to end of disease. Now, you could also say end of disease is where things are healed because the body's supposed to be self-healing. But most of the time, that's not what we think about with disease timeline in that. So if you think about a joint, you know, let's take a look at this. This is just sort of a cartoonish picture. You've got bones, you've got cartilage lining that, and then joint fluid. Every joint has a bursa, which fluid in it, to keep that lubricated. It allows the bones to glide easily in that. And that pumping mechanism, when we use it, flows fluid in and out of here, and it helps keep that joint healthy. So the worst thing you can do is sit around and not do anything, because then the bones do start to deteriorate without that activity. And so inflammation of a joint is particularly starts with soft tissues around the knee. That hold it together and start to cause the discomfort. So, you know, literally things get inflamed. Again, that's sort of a cartoon, if you will, with everything looking inflamed and on fire. But that's literally what an inflamed joint feels like. It feels like it's on fire, and then you start to think, what can I do about it? And you start to grab those non-steroidals. So I like to tell everybody, movement prevents arthritis. It's that joint pumping motion using those elbows. And the shoulders, if they're hurting, is keeping active with it is really important. And there are good studies that show even if you have pain in a joint, activity actually decreases the joint over time, as long as you're not doing something to damage the joint where you're overusing it. So think about a car accident. I think many of us have probably been in a car accident. Here's this lady that's got some neck pain. But you think about what happens during a car accident. And many of us have had car accidents. And then we start to have back pain or neck pain, and you don't think about it, but that was 15, 20 years ago. And you can set up some of these injuries years before. So force equals mass times acceleration. You've got a big vehicle that's going along at 30, 40 miles per hour, and it suddenly stops, and your neck is jumping all over the place, or your back is. And you know, you think about the movement that happens suddenly in that and what's going on internally. You can fracture bones, get microfractures that heal again, but it does set up chronic inflammation. Here's a great example of inflammation and wear and tear. You know, if you look at a normal vertebrae in the lumbar spine, a lot of people have back problems. That's the number one cause why people go to the doctor or go to the emergency room, because they have acute back pain. So if you look at normal, you know, you've got a nice cushion in here, and this is the jelly donut in here that herniates out and compresses the nerves. And you can see as things change, you start to lose and you get a little compression on that. You start to get a little inflammation in that nucleus pulposus, as we call it. And that progresses along, and you can start to see some of this damage, the osteoarthritic changes in the bones themselves, in the compression. You can see you're starting to lose joint space, and as you're doing that, as we age, we lose height with that. And then with pressure from the vertebrae above it, you can start to see some herniation of that nucleus pulposus. And these nerve roots right here that come out between the spine bones, if that squeezes on that nerve, that's what causes that shooting pain down the leg that makes us so acutely uncomfortable. And then in the last phase, you can see you've pretty much your bone on bone, and that can cause significant pain. And so we really want to work on trying to slow this process down with the aging and staying active with that. Because once you get to this end point, then you're talking about major surgery to fix things like that. So what happens in a typical treatment cycle? So, you know, hey, I got some knee pain. You've got an acute injury from that. You have some joint pain, so what do? You grab some of those non-steroidals, Aleve, ibuprofen, whatever, and then maybe those don't work and the pain gets better. So you call the doctor and he says, well, I'll give you a prescription for a stronger one of those, it's prescription. And then maybe that doesn't work and you end up with some plain x-rays because the insurance company says, well, you can't just have an MRI right away. You have to jump through all these hoops. And so that doesn't work. And so then maybe your doctor says, hey, let's put a little steroid in there. And that settles down inflammation acutely, but it also slows down the healing process. Remember, we need some of that acute inflammation to start the healing process. And those non-steroidals actually can prolong it, as do the cortisone injections. Again, that acute pain is needed to heal. If it's chronic, it's different. So then maybe you get to that MRI and you figure out, okay, what's going on? Then you may need a scope to figure out, okay, can we go in there and trim off some of the cartilage or whatever, repair something. And then you may have surgery, and then ultimately you may have joint pain again because surgery doesn't always fix the problem. And then you start thinking, okay, well, what's next? So let's talk about those non-steroidals a bit. I touched on this a little bit. You know, what do they really do? Well, the purpose is to alleviate the pain, because nobody likes pain, you want to get rid of it, so it alleviates it at the nerve level or the brain and spinal cord level, but it lowers the inflammation at the site, which is kind of what you want. You want to relieve that inflammation, but then we've got to pay the piper. They don't address the cause of the tissue damage, so the tissue damage continues even though you've controlled the pain. So you've blocked that signaling mechanism that's supposed to tell you there's something wrong, and you don't continue to do something about it because it's better. And they don't heal or regenerate anything. They actually can worsen the whole healing and regeneration cycle. And of course, non-steroidal medications are linked to ulcers, heart attacks, dialysis if you really kick off your kidneys, and 15,000 or more deaths per year. And so long term, this is not a solution, I don't think. So what's next? Well, let's talk about a cortisone injection. I've done cortisone injections. These work great for somebody that's got the weekend warrior thing that's drug on a little bit longer and they got to get back to work and they can't hobble around wherever they're working at. And so if you inject a little steroid in there, it settles the inflammation down quickly. If they don't have any major ligamentous damage or something like that, you can settle that down. And it can actually break down some scar tissue if they've got some scar tissue that's broken down, so they can be helpful. If you continue to use them, you actually start to affect your bone density and you start to damage your cartilage because they actually degrade or stop the healing of new bone formation and those chondrocytes that help your cartilage heal. And so long-term, bad. So it can eventually worsen or speed up the joint degeneration, which is definitely not what we want. And of course, it's temporary and then it wears off and they need another injection. And so most of the orthopedic doctors would say 3 injections per year is the maximum. And you can kick up diabetes with that. So the cortisone kicks up your blood sugar. And so 4 times max, I would say 3 times max, because otherwise you really start to speed up the degeneration. Now, if you're, you know, not a surgical candidate and that's all we've got left to do, you do what you can do. Hyaluronic acid, most people would call this the rooster comb, if you will. You know, it's a bioidentical replacement. It just replaces the fluid, that joint fluid we have in there. It provides a little bit of cushion. So it relieves pain. It's a natural substance. We actually make it ourselves to repair cartilage. But it really doesn't help you grow new cartilage. It just provides more cushion, and it's temporary. So FDA approved for knees only, not for other joints, because those are the major cushion joints that we need help with. It's safe. A lot of insurance plans will cover it for knees only again. That's like putting a little WD-40 in the joint. It provides some temporary relief, so you have to replete it every 4 to 6 months to get relief from that, but you're not fixing anything. So it buys time and can put off surgery if you're at that point. So next thing, if those things don't work, what do we do next? Well, and we start thinking about surgery. And we replace a lot of joints, and some people do really well with those. You know, and here are some of the tools they use to look in there. You can see they've got a tool in here to kind of manipulate things and shave things off. They've got a port to put air in, and then a camera. You can see the light from the camera in there. Here's what a knee joint itself looks like, the metal component, and then the plastic component, and a new plastic kneecap when they put those in. And so for some people that works well. Here's, you know, going in to do some cartilage repair. They've got a suture in here where they're suturing things together. So if you've got a cartilage tear, those can be repaired, but healing is slow. So here's something I learned the hard way. My mom had a knee joint replaced. And, you know, you can see here's a normal knee and here's a knee replacement. And you can look, when you look at this, you know, you look at the bone, they have to cut through some of the bone to put these replacement pieces in. And what happened with my mom, she started to develop her Alzheimer's dementia about a year after she had this knee replaced. And I didn't realize this at the time, that when you have problems with toxins, and we live in a toxic world, a lot of these toxins are stored in the bone. And so if you start cutting through the bone, those metals, number one, are toxic to the bone and cartilage growth. So those can speed degeneration of the joint as well. But those metals can be released during surgery. And then you've got the perfect storm. You've got anesthesia, because they need you to put to sleep when they're using that Sawzall to cut through that bone. You don't want to feel that. And you're cringing a little bit about that, but that's literally what it is. It's a nitrogen-powered Sawzall. And you need that anesthesia because you want to be asleep, but that opens up the blood-brain barrier, and this is a barrier to prevent toxins from getting to your brain. So you open up the blood-brain barrier and you're liberating these toxins that are floating around, and they end up going to the brain. And I think everybody's heard aluminum can lead to dementia, and so that's one of them, but lead and cadmium, some of the other heavy metals, can as well. And so that's when my mom started having issues with that, and I've seen that in numerous other patients over the years since that time. Hip surgery, same sort of thing. You can see we've got this stem in the lower bone, but you can see they shaved off a chunk of that bone right in there. And then they put in the plastic capsule for the socket to fit into, and you've got some screws that go into the pelvis to fix that. These are done mostly at Medicare, but we do 800,000 a year, and weight and age, of course, increases the risk of complications. And so if you're younger and generally healthier, you do better with that. But at some points we have to do that if your body can't heal it again and you've tried it. And then of course we have recovery after surgery. Now this person had both knees done, which is not done all that much. My mother-in-law had both of hers done, and she was a pretty brave lady, but she said, I'm only doing this once because all my friends told me it hurts. And she had both done and she did well, but if you get an infection in both of them, you're really in a mess. You know, recovery, you need to do some therapy or walking around with a brace, you know, and it can be painful to do the rehab. And then, you know, if things don't go so well, you can end up with a wound infection. So I've had three people in the last year that have had wound infections, one knee and two hips that had to be removed, and then they were without those joints in place in a wheelchair or other means to get around while they got IV antibiotics. And then they reimplanted them. The one lady with the hip had it done a second time because the replacement got reinfected because they didn't get all the bacteria cleared up. And all three are now going to be basically on lifetime antibiotics. And that leads us down the pathway of antibiotic resistance. It affects your gut bacteria, which are your immune system. And so it starts to compromise your immune system long term. And that's another problem, you know, and knee joints and some of those in particular, you know, what's the lifespan? Most of the orthopedic docs will tell you 10 to 15 years. So the younger you are, you want to postpone that because you're going to wear it out and you're going to lead to a second one. If you replace a knee the second time, what do you do if you have to do it a third time if you do it early? Well, there is no third time because it just doesn't work. Most of the time people end up with an amputation, and I don't think most people talk about that. And so it's not the be-all and end-all. So we talk about regenerative revolution. It's like helping the body trying to heal and restore rather than replacing the joints. If we get to it early enough, we can do that, you know, so regaining your health so you can live your best life, basically, and restoring the body's ability to heal, I think, is important. And like I said, the body is designed to heal, and regenerative therapy helps or stimulates the body's own ability to start to heal from within. And we want to repair, replace damaged cells or tissue at a cellular level. And so we start thinking about, okay, what at the cellular level is impeding the healing? And the number one thing, like I mentioned before, is diet, and we're going to get to that again. So some of the things we use, platelet-rich plasma, which is basically using your own blood. We centrifuge that, and then we have this PRP, which I call the liquid gold. We all have platelets in our body, and that's why it's called platelet-rich plasma. And the platelets, what happens if you cut yourself, the platelets are the first people to arrive as a healing repair mechanism. They stop the bleeding, so you don't bleed to death. And then they call in those other healing factors, the cytokines that we mentioned already, to start and continue the healing process with that. And we've found if we take these platelets and we concentrate them like this and inject them into an area, we can really speed up the healing, because now instead of saying we have one person in there yelling for help, we've got hundreds or thousands of people calling for help, and they will recruit that. And so this is like adding fertilizer to a joint to stimulate healing. We need those messengers to signal the cytokines and call for help with that, if you will. And so this is what we call our oh-so-good shot, and I call it that because it's used for so many different things. So it stimulates your own healing system, and no chance of abnormal reactions because of that. I don't know if you've ever seen blood in a test tube. When we spin it down, the top part is the plasma, that's the watery portion. The bottom part are the red blood cells, and then in between that is the white blood cells and platelets, and only about 4% of that. So we draw off a pretty good volume of blood to process that so we can do that. But we use platelets for so many different things in the body nowadays. We use it for women for urinary incontinence. It does help with orgasm. As we know, nothing gets better with aging. For men, we do the same thing. We've had people that have erectile dysfunction or problems with sensation. And again, injecting the PRP helps with the healing with that. We use it for cosmetic things. So for acne pitting, for instance, you can tell before and after with that, it really stimulates collagen production. And that's what it does in the joint as well. It can stimulate collagen healing by providing fertilizer, if you will, and the mechanism to heal that. We use it for hair restoration. So as your hair starts to thin, we can do injections of PRP into the scalp, and it can stimulate healing as well. And this happens to both men and women. The female pattern baldness can be particularly distressing for women as they age. A lot of us, as we get older, if we get balder, we're just sexy, right? Women, unfortunately, generally are not told that they're sexy if they're having thin hair. So that's one of those fun things with our society. Ozone is one of my favorite modalities. We use a lot of ozone in the clinic in here to treat all kinds of things. So ozone is basically three oxygen molecules hooked together. If you take oxygen, you run it past an electric current, the O2 separates and it recombines it with the electricity in three oxygen molecules, and then it becomes a sterilizer. So it's used to destroy bacteria, viruses, molds, and odors. If you go to a hotel and you check in and somebody smoked in the room, they will bring an ozone generator and set it up in your room, and it will get rid of the cigarette smoke odor. We use it in here to run on the weekends to get rid of viruses and bacteria. We use it in our home at home to kill insects so we don't have to spray toxic chemicals in our house. It will kill those. But you have to get plants and animals out of the house because it will kill them also. So you got to move the plants someplace safe, and you want to get Fluffy or Fifi out of the house because it won't do well for them either. You can't breathe ozone. We can inject it in the body, but you can't breathe it because it's toxic to the lungs. In other countries, they use it for infections, illnesses, and they even use it for cancer treatments. And it's been used as early as the 1900s. So in Germany, they used to use this for wound infections during World War I and World War II. So if you think it's been around a long time. So ozone literally punches a hole in the pathogen cell wall, and they can't live with that. This is a process called oxidation. Remember the mitochondria producing those oxidative, those toxins or cellular dust, that's oxidation or rusting. So what we're doing is we're literally killing that. So there's no known resistance to any pathogens to the killing power of oxidation. So unlike the antibiotics and antivirals, the bacteria outsmart them by changing their structure. So it's the perfect healing molecule for many of the infections in the body, and we use it a lot for stimulating healing. So we do major autohemotherapy. We take blood out, we ozonate it, put it back into the body, and that can actually stimulate cells, stem cell production and release, so actually boost what your body's capable of doing. UVBI is called ultraviolet blood irradiation. We use UV light. UV light kills bacteria. I'm sure you've seen those if you go to the hospital or a restaurant. They've got them sitting around. And we combine it with the ozone, and so we've got both of them working together. And what we literally do with that is we can make a vaccine out of whatever virus or bacteria is in your body, and it can actually help the immune system then search out those other pathogens in the body. And we use it a lot for autoimmune disease because it has a nice balancing effect on the immune system that's overactive. Prolozone is another thing we do for joints. We use procaine, which is a healing anesthetic, some B12, which is healing, some dextrose, and Tramiol, which is a homeopathic medication. And we use it for acutely inflamed joints. So for an acute infection or acute inflammation that's been going on too long and is interfering with people's function, we can inject that in rather than steroid, and it actually stimulates a healing process rather than damaging the joint. And the ozone, together with that, helps oxygenate that joint. Remember we said the joint needs more oxygen to heal, and so putting some ozone in helps with that as well. So here's one of my Lyme patients. She's getting a UVBI treatment, so we're basically making a vaccine out of her blood to go after and kill the Lyme infection that she has in her body. You can see the blood in the bag right here. Here's our ozone generator down here, and we literally pull it out, put it in the bag, ozonate it, and then reinfuse it into the body. This has a UV light in here, or UV lights, several different ones for different UV wavelengths to kill viruses and bacteria. And that's really effective. So next step, I want to talk about, you know, the regenerative revolution and stem cells. And all you have to do is go on the internet. Everybody's talking about stem cells. Every major university in the country is doing research on stem cells. And that's a really hot topic. And the FDA is all over this stuff. And they may very well tell us that we can't use our own stem cells anymore. Later this year, they've had an advisory out, and people have been commenting on that. But people go out of the country all the time to have stem cell therapy done, and it's really sad because you can heal the body. The stem cells are basically the template that changes, or that can change to become tissues from bone to tendons to glands and organs when we're developing. Once we're born, that mechanism where these stem cells can become other tissues goes away. Our stem cells can do healing, but they can't, again, change into something different. You would need undifferentiated stem cells, and so you'd need, you know, if you think about breast cancer treatment, they take stem cells out, they take them to the lab, they process them, and in that process, they stimulate them, they turn them back on again, so they again have the ability to make new bone marrow, and then they reinfuse them to literally rebuild your bone marrow for that. But that can only be done in a laboratory, and the FDA won't allow us to do that for joints in that. It has not been approved for that, but you can actually re-stimulate our own stem cells to be able to reform organs. But initially, when we're born, stem cells develop all of our initial muscle cells and the skin cells. I mean, so every cell and organ in our body starts out from stem cells. They form all of those things, tendons, organs, and they even make more stem cells. And so once we're born, that mechanism for those stem cells to be able to change into other cells goes away. And so if anybody tells you that this guy, which is sort of a representation of what a stem cell does, is going to make new cartilage, they're lying through their teeth. Okay, it doesn't work that way. Stem cells basically are messengers. So I tell everybody stem cells function, the mesenchymal stem cells are the ones that produce connective tissue. So framework for organs, nerves, muscles, ligaments, tendons, and cartilage. And so we want mesenchymal stem cells to help heal cartilage like in a knee joint or whatever. And these stem cells, the way I look at them, they are messengers. They're like a taxi, and the taxi's filled with all the information. So it's like a textbook. It's got the genetic material and information it needs for our own stem cells that are still present to start to do the repair work. So they stimulate and regrow our own stem cells. And again, like platelets, if you concentrate them and inject them into one joint, you can get that benefit of the recruitment of multiple ones in a small area, and it can start to heal that. So we also have blood-forming stem cells. So those are called hematopoietic stem cells. I know that's a big word, but they're found in cord blood, and they form red blood cells and white blood cells. So we need those to keep the ability to form our own red cells and white cells. So where we get a lot of our stem cells would be from our umbilical cord. So Wharton's jelly is part of the umbilical cord, and it provides the cushioning around those blood vessels. And that amniotic membrane is a barrier that protects the baby from mom's immune system. But it's also the protective layer in the cord. It's called Wharton's jelly there. And that's the richest source of mesenchymal stem cells in the human body. Well, most of us don't have our placenta at home in the freezer, and so we can't do anything with that. And so what we have done is there are companies that actually manufacture or extract the stem cells out of those and process those and freeze them, and then we can inject them. And then again, I want to make sure that people understand those stem cells do not grow new cartilage. Those stem cells contain information in them that will allow our stem cells to do the healing. So the stem cells themselves are not what do the project. It's our own stem cells and our own body's healing mechanism. So they provide fertilizer and information that our own stem cells need to do the job that they're perhaps too tired or too small in number to do. Cord blood, we have lots of hematopoietic stem cells in that, and we use those a lot for the cosmetic procedures because they have a lot of hyaluronic acid, and that's what we lose as we age and we start to get wrinkles with that. So the cytokines and those growth factors that we need, so we can use those for all kinds of things. Now, you know, people talk about, well, this is new stuff. Not really. We've been using regenerative things. So here, preserved amniotic membrane has been used for burned and ulcerated surfaces, substituting for skin grafts. And you know, this has been going on a long time. This goes all the way back to 1913. So this is not that new. We've been doing some of this for many, many years. It's just recently where we're starting to realize we can't afford to continue to do the things we're doing, and we need to go back to allowing the body to heal, and that's where the stem cells come in the body to help heal things. And the sad part is, you know, maybe we'll end up having to go out of the country to have those done. You know, here's a mom, hopefully eating a healthy diet, and she's going to be somebody that we can collect her placenta after she has a healthy delivery, and we can use that to obtain the Wharton's jelly and some of the amniotic tissue. So these products are FDA cleared. They are donated by healthy moms after healthy live birth, and then they're processed in a clean room environment that exceeds the American Association of Tissue Bank standards. The company won't even use women's placentas if they have tattoos, because tattoo ink stimulates immune system issues, and they want to avoid that. So they're very particular about that, and these women are tested and screened through their entire pregnancy to look for, obviously, things like drugs and other toxins in their body. And so, you know, using those regenerative tissues, stem cells in the tissue building blocks, growth factors, proteins, collagen, hyaluronic acid, and cytokines that stimulate that healing, and that's really what we want to use those for. Obviously, our own stem cells are the best choice because you can't react to them. But if you're to the point where you don't have enough to do the job, or you're unhealthy enough to really have healthy ones where you can produce enough to get a benefit, then we need to look outside the body, and they stimulate those regenerative tissues that your body needs to start healing what it does. So recent research and clinical literature, you know, it can help heal cartilage, ligament, tendons, muscles, discs, bone, nerves. And so we're using those for all kinds of different things. So how do we do this? Obviously, you need to examine the joint. This one in particular, we're looking at a knee. This is a simple thing in the office, you know, where we start out with an in-office procedure. Generally takes about an hour for us to do the examination. There's no anesthesia except for some local skin anesthesia. No hospital stay, no antibiotics, because we don't want to cause problems with that. Generally zero recovery time from the actual procedure itself. And clinically, we expect significantly improved function in 1 to 3 months. I generally shoot for the 3 months or longer because it takes time for our body to ramp up the healing mechanism, and then depends on what kind of injury you've got present, how long it takes for the body really to start healing again. Minimal adverse effects. Well, you know, you could get an infection site ache or some swelling. One of the interesting things that I do in the office, because we inject, you know, we're doing an injection, and I really want to avoid any issues with that, I've started putting some ozone into joints when we're doing the stem cells, which provide oxygen, which is good for the healing process, but it also really gets rid of any of the bacteria or viruses that could potentially cause any problems with an injection. So I just wanted to show a couple of cases. These are younger people, a 43-year-old female with, you know, debilitating right knee pain. There's no specific trauma that she can remember, but over 2 years the knee pain worsened. She wasn't able to climb stairs except sideways when she got out of a car. She had a lot of pain with that. She stopped exercise for 6 months, and she had some ligament tears noted in the knee joint and a history of arthritis. So she's got some underlying inflammatory stuff going on, and we need to address really the inflammation, which goes back to diet and lifestyle. So day of an injection, we start with that, and then a week later, mild inflammation. It's not uncommon when we inject the stem cells or PRP or whatever into the joint, you expect some of that inflammation. Remember, we need some generalized inflammation to start the healing process, so we'd expect that. And then for her, 4 weeks later, she's able to wear her heels for a 2-day conference, able to do a full squat, so she could get a case of water to the bottom of the shopping cart, and she wasn't able to do a squat for quite some time. And then 12 weeks later, she's 95% better, and she started running again, pain-free squatting, and, you know, it's kind of strange not having her knees bother anymore, which is kind of a neat thing. And so the body's capable of healing, and if we add some fertilizer to that, we can stimulate the process and really get a good outcome with that. 45-year-old male, again, similar age, bilateral knee pain that's getting worse. Same sort of thing, no specific trauma, various knee strains with sports. So remember, we talked about precipitating things, and a lot of times people don't even remember those things. Over the last year, knee pain worsened. He wasn't able to do squats with workouts. Squatting is really hard on the knee joints. If you don't believe me, try it and stay down for a bit. They really start aching. He stopped running for 3 months, and he had to modify his workout for the last months because he's having more discomfort. And he started using a lot of Aleve, and guess what? He started having some stomach pain with that. And that's not uncommon if you use that on a regular basis, because you're actually blocking the healing process in your gut again with those anti-inflammatory medications. Similar kind of story, did an injection. A week afterwards, he's able to run up and down stairs with minimal pain or discomfort. 4 weeks afterwards, 80% better. He could squat with almost no pain, so we're making some good progress with that. And then end of 2 months, 95% better, able to return to exercise, pain-free running, squatting, and lifting. So 40-year-olds do really well with these sorts of things. And, you know, so end of 2 months, like I said, 3 months or so is kind of where we start to see the best outcomes. So I've just got some representative x-rays to look at that. You know, here's a knee. You can see we've got a little better joint lines over here, but we've got some area here that looks bone on bone, and you can see some of the thicker white right here. That's some of the osteoarthritis, as it's called, where we've got damage actually from that being almost what you would call bone on bone, because we don't see a lot of joint space in there. And so here we've got from July until April, and you can see we're starting to get some joint space in there. So the body is capable of healing, and a lot of people are told, oh, your joint's bone on bone, we better do knee surgery. Well, if you can regenerate some of that, and even if you get a 50% improvement and you decrease your pain, would be that be a good thing to avoid surgery? In my mind, it would, because there are no real down risks with this, and there are with the surgery. Another case, and you know, here we've got again both middle sorts of the knee. So this is somebody that may be somewhat knock-kneed, as we would call it, you know, so the mechanics are off with that. And it's both internal parts of the knee with that. We've got good outspacing outside, but this person would probably benefited with a little bit of bracing because the knees are just doing this to themselves with the architecture. And so, you know, just doing a little bit of therapy for muscle strengthening to start to work on some of that balance with that. Like I said, we work with physical therapists and chiropractors if we need to do that, whatever we need to do to start to get some progress. And you can see from February to September, we're starting to see some improvement in the joint space in here. And that could be from muscle strengthening, from bracing, and we do use braces as well to open that knee joint up and allow those tissue healing fluids to circulate in there and really do the best job for those. Another one here, you can see, you know, one knee looks particularly different than the other one. You can see a lot of that whitish layer here, so you've got some damage to the bone just from pressure. And you would probably say, hey, this looks kind of like bone on bone in here, but there's still some cushion in there. And so again, you notice this is a heavier person because you can see the size of the thighs in here, and weight is not our friend. And so if you think about that gravity, 1 pound of weight is 4 pounds when you step down. And so losing weight and really working on the diet and inflammation does a lot to help with the healing process. You can see quite a bit of change with that joint. And so again, doing some mechanical stuff to change muscle strengthening and structure with a physical therapist can do a lot of things to help open that joint up, and then he can start to do some healing to generate some cartilage in that joint again if you add some fertilizer in with that. And this one looks particularly bad. You've got a little bit on both sides, but again, some of the shift with alignment also, and again, you know, from November until April, we can still see we're still shifted, but we've got some increase in that. And so this is not just injections, but this is, again, physical therapy tied in with this and muscle strengthening, changing the diet around. So the way I want to say this, really, if you think about this, if you plant seeds, you throw a bunch of seeds on top of the clay soil, it's not going to grow very well. But if you work on improving the soil that you're going to plant the seeds on, they will generally grow better. And so putting fertilizer in there, if you will, and getting that joint ready and working on that joint as you're doing injections, you can really start to do the healing process. So cost of joint replacement, I don't know anywhere where it's done free unless you go to Britain or Germany, and it's not free there either. And they only do so many for a year, and people come here to have those things done because they can get them done when they want to. But you're talking $25,000 to $50,000 or more for a knee replacement. And then if you have insurance, out-of-pocket deductible coinsurance can be up to $15,000. It gets to be pretty pricey. And so ultimately, what's the value of your healthy, active life? How do you see yourself getting around as you're getting older? You know, do you want to be active and doing what you want to do? And so in my mind, healing is a good thing. So here's something to think about. You know, we kind of looked at that video initially, the value of your active life, nursing home costs. I mean, average for a private room is about $8,400 a year, or $275 a day. And you think about that, that's an ongoing cost. And the average cost in a semi-private room is $245 a day. And so it really depends on, okay, what do you want to do as you get older? You want to be sitting around in a nursing home, or do you want to be out playing golf? And this is, again, sort of a contrast that I made. Happy at home or $275 in a nursing home. And these two couples do not look equally happy, I would say. And so, again, what's your why? Why would you want to do something about improving your health, helping your body heal itself? Will you be able to drive a car later, care for yourself, go for a hike, or play with your grandkids? You know, what do you want to see yourself doing? My why would be Miss Nova. This is my granddaughter who's 5. This is actually my sister right here, and we're sitting here cross-legged playing a game with her. I still want to teach her how to water ski. I still water ski and do crazy stuff like that, and I still want to continue to do that. There's some things I won't do, like learning how to wakeboard. Some of my younger friends have tried to get me to do that, and we don't bounce so well anymore as we get older, so I'm not going to try that. But my why is I want to remain active. I want to be able to get around and do that. And I have 95-year-old patients that fly to Florida in the winter months, and they play golf on a regular basis, and that's my goal. I want to keep myself healthy and be able to do what I want to do. You know, so my goal here is to help people live their best life. I see my job here as a parent. You educate your kids, you get them ready for the world, and you send them out. So you work yourself out of a job. Traditional medicine in the United States wants to keep you coming back for stuff. My goal is to educate you, let you understand what's going on with your body so you can find the underlying cause and then work to allow your body to start healing again. And so I want to work myself out of your job. You know, if you have to come back once in a while for a little booster or something, that's fine. But I really want to allow you to get out and live your best life. So why choose Renew for your regenerative care? I've been doing joint injections for 20 years. I'm board certified in functional regenerative medicine. I know how to discover the root cause of health issues and help you start to learn to understand what it is and how we can fix it. We use an integrated approach, like I mentioned, chiropractors, physical therapy, whatever we need to do, dietitians, because we talked about the importance of diet and diet and diet. And it's office-based care, so comfort and low risk of infections, unlike in the hospital. Comprehensive patient outpatient monitoring, institutional review board for data collection and FDA review. And we keep a close eye on our patients. I know there's some places where you can go get stem cells done, you get your injection and you leave, and nobody ever follows up on you. I like to keep tabs on people and follow up with them, see how they're doing in the weeks and months afterwards. And you know, it helps if you work with somebody that's local. And I know there's some places where people travel from, say, Chicago or St. Louis and just come and do injections and then they disappear again. And ultimately, you don't have any continuity with that. So the